This is the story of an extraordinary life. It's the story of Danny Lewin, who accomplished more in 31 years than most of us can hope to accomplish in a lifetime or several lifetimes. It's the story of a life cut tragically short and of a legacy that lives on every day in the rapid speed of the internet and the success of Akamai to the memories of a friend who remains a living legend to everyone who knew him. Until now, the story of our friend, Danny, has been largely untold. But 10 years after his untimely death, on the 10th anniversary of September 11th, friends, family, and colleagues want you to know about his brilliance, his tenacity, his warmth, his life, his legacy.
Came from special stock. You know, his parents are unbelievably bright people, also off the charts. His brothers are super special people. But he had a level of intensity and energy, which there was just never a downtime. It's as if like there was a premonition that, hey, this guy's only got, 31 years, on this earth, and he's got to pack everything in as quickly as he possibly could.
Danny was born in Denver, Colorado in 1970. And he grew up in Denver until the age of 14. Rocky Mountain High,
Colorado. I think my earliest memory of Danny is probably sitting together with him in our basement playroom. And I'm playing with blocks. And he's helping me build a fortress. The concept of the game was to try to bring cars to knock down the blocks of the fortress. And the stronger you can make the fortress, all the better. And so I was building the fortress, and he was giving me advice on the side. And sometimes kind of really telling me what to do.
I have strong memories of times where we were in family outings. We were in the Colorado Rockies. I have vague memories of myself, Michael, and Danny playing around on the rocks and building forts and kind of war games. Danny was always very energetic and happy and full with life. In general, Danny's personality, there was two sides that people saw. There was the external kind of very strong, maybe sometimes a little harsh with people, very pushing forward and super energy. And then people that were close to him learned that he had a very soft and tender and caring side.
So my father was always in a very natural manner trying to create an environment where we always had intellectual stimulants. And I think one of the least stimulating thing in the breakfast was the standard backs of the cereals where we would spend our time reading the cartoons or looking at the ingredients of Cocoa Puffs. So my father decided, without actually asking anyone, but just doing it his own way, cutting out articles of different magazines, scientific magazines, math problems, riddles, and posting them on the back of the cereal boxes. So we were a little disappointed at the beginning where we weren't able to view our favorite cartoons anymore. But soon, actually, the reality forced us to start reading these articles, and it was interesting. Danny was just starting the intricacies of American high school lifestyle and culture. And I think my father decided that as a family, we should be spending our time dealing with more ideological issues.
Danny went to Israel kicking and screaming. He was brought to Israel by his parents. And even at a young age, he was exceptionally articulate in describing why his parents decided to move there. If I remember correctly, he told me that his dad was a psychiatrist who turned out to look at other passions and became a poet.
And then after becoming a poet, he got very interested in Israel and Judaism and told the family one day, we're moving to Israel.
A story that's very representative of his personality was that when we, coming to Israel, we had a family outing to vacation to go through Europe for a month. Danny decided he didn't want to participate in this whole family outing. He doesn't want to go to museums and all kinds of those kind of things that my parents would want to do. And so he decided he's going to go to a kibbutz to be a volunteer on a kibbutz.
When we arrived, he joined us, and he seemed to say that we had a great time at the kibbutz. We enjoyed Europe, but I think his ability to grow up kind of early was important for him.
I met Danny when he was 16 and a high school student. And the rumors at the time, later confirmed by Danny, were essentially that high school was not stimulating for him. And he was one step ahead of the truant officer. So he wasn't often going to class, preferred to solve mathematical problems, work out at the gym, socialize, dream about what he wanted to do in the IDF. And so high school was a bit of a blur, but obviously he did very well, and I remember him telling me he took the PSAT and SAT for fun. And he got a perfect score in the math and almost a perfect score in English. And as someone who did not get those kind of scores, I was a bit astonished by it all. He was drafted in the IDF, and this is something that he thought about a lot. And there was no question whether he would serve. And there was no question whether he would serve in a combat unit. And there was no question in his mind that he would serve in the country's most elite unit. And that's what he ended up doing.
Danny and I were both very passionate about where we met, which is the Army. We both wanted to be in these good fighting units. He was a great soldier. I think it was a combination of, A, he was incredibly physically fit, which helps a lot. So he could carry a lot of weight, walk long distances, keep doing that for a long time. B, I think it's this sort of natural aggressiveness in pushing forward for getting things done. C, it was the smarts. A lot of the things require planning first, thinking about how to do something smartly rather than just how to do it. And he was very good at that too. He would do above and beyond what was required. So I remember this one exercise where we were walking, and I was looking at Danny, and he was walking slower than usual, and he was having a harder time climbing up the hills or making the turns, or crouching down with the gear and then getting back up. And this was unlike Danny. Usually he'd be one of the stronger guys. And at the end, I asked him what happened. And it turned out that he had taken about twice as much gear as he should have just because he wanted to push himself. And that was pretty common with Danny.
I first met Danny, I was living in Israel at the time. I'm actually originally from Belgium. I was living in a little apartment and I had a roommate from the United States. You know, we were a student, broke, didn't have a car, and we wanted to go out and dance. And she said, oh, I have a friend that has a friend that has a car. And I think I'm going to call them and maybe they can, you know, we didn't want to pay for a cab to go dancing. I guess I really liked him from the first time I laid my eyes on him. And we went out to dance. We danced together all night. Lambada, can you imagine Danny dancing the Lambada with me? He was a very outdoorsy kind of guy, so we went a lot on hikes. We took the car, well, his parents' car. It wasn't even his car, by the way. When he brought his car for us to go out, it was broke too. He was an Israeli soldier. It was actually his parents' car, a really old, raggedy, white station wagon. So we went on a hike. Israel is a beautiful country. You have all kind of you know, and you have lakes, you have desert, you have mountains. Danny really liked the desert, so he said, I'm going to take you on my favorite hike in the desert. So we went there. It took us about 2 hours to get to a beautiful spot where you would just stand and there were cliffs for, I don't know, 100 meters. And we were alone there, no one. And then we were looking at the view. And he just looked at me and said, I love you so much. let's get married. I said, yes. And all his friends actually always laughed at him because they said he took me there on that cliff. So if I said no. 6 months later, we weren't married. So it was intense.
I think Anne had a grounding effect on him. He needed somebody to sort of ground him because he would have just, this is an expression, but he would have just, burned out or gone crazy by not having sort of a home where he can also calm down and relax and not have to constantly prove himself.
I got pregnant with Z really fast. And I think 3 months after we got married, I was already pregnant.
After the military, Danny was accepted at the Technion. And the Technion is best described as Israel's version of MIT.
But he decided to do two things at the same time. I think he did engineer degree and math, as if one wasn't enough.
But he had an amazing ability to juggle a lot of balls simultaneously. So while he was going to the Technion, he also was a researcher at IBM, which was a very, very prestigious position. There were only four research centers that IBM had at the time around the world, and one was in Haifa. And that's where Danny was doing very cutting-edge work, some of which I understand could have perhaps influenced the work that he did with Tom at MIT.
If I remember properly, we were just not sure what we wanted to do with our life next. Yeah, we were, life wasn't easy. We weren't making a lot of money. He had brought home a book from school, and I can't remember what the book was about, but I know that he read about Tom Layton in it. And he came back home, he said, oh my God, this professor is amazing. He wrote this sexy algorithm. I was like, what is sexy in an algorithm? No, sexy algorithm. And I would love to meet him. And I think he teaches at MIT. And anyway, it wouldn't be nice to go to the United States and I have my BA, but I would like to have a master in something. And I applied to all the Ivy Leagues, like Stanford, MIT, Caltech, and what do you know, every week we got a big envelope. At the time it wasn't email, right? It was just big envelope, small one was bad, big one was good. And from each and every one. So here were the choices now. Where are we going to go? I wanted to go to Stanford because I heard that the dorms were beautiful and California is beautiful and that's where I wanted to go. But he said, you know what? I think I want to go to MIT because of Tom. I want to meet the guy.
You know, Danny had a way of standing out quickly. He wasn't the shy, retiring type. And I got to know him early on because he was my teaching assistant when he came to MIT. And so, I could see how he thought about problems, how he interacted with students, how he helped them to work harder and to be smarter themselves, and to help teach them. And he himself was exceptionally brilliant. And that, came out, very quickly, I would say.
For the first time he met Tom, he was extremely impressed and frustrated at the same time because he was just a regular student. That was his goal from the beginning. I have to prove to Tom that I am better than anyone else, that I am special, and that was his goal. On the home front, it was tough because I was with two babies. I actually was accepted at Boston College at the time. To come to MIT, we had to take loans. As the years went by, the loans grew bigger and bigger. And I remember us both waking up in the middle of the night in sweats and saying to ourselves, oh my God, how are we ever going to pay those back?
Danny was hard up for money. And he didn't complain and he didn't fetch. And part of making ends meet was sweeping the hallways of his graduate student dorm. Part of making ends meet was not wearing a jacket in his first two winters in Cambridge.
The first time we met was just, they were looking for somebody to take care of the little boy. Donnie and Ann saw our ad and they came down with their little 2-month-old boy at the time, Itamar. And that's the first time we met him, and they just seemed like a very friendly couple at the time. I didn't really have any you know, distinct impression, apart from the fact that I knew he was a PhD candidate at the Laboratory of Computer Science at MIT, which is pretty impressive.
In 1997, if you look at what the consumer internet was really all about, the majority of people from their homes were still accessing the internet on dial-up modems, and so as much as that's something that people barely remember, you know, I think that those of us who were there can still hear the modem protocol, the chirping of the modem before it can, you know, when it dialed up, before it connected to the server. Performance was one of the major impediments to mainstream adoption. That arose as a combination of a few factors. One was, of course, the limited access speed that people had at home over dial-up modems. But the other constraints were around the actual architecture of the internet.
I had a group that was working on algorithms for large-scale networks starting in 95, inspired by Tim Berners-Lee, who was down the hall from my office. And when Danny came in 96, he immediately gravitated towards the work that we were doing on how would you make the web work when a lot of people are trying to access one site at the same time. He had brilliant ideas about how you decide what to store where, and how do you do routing kinds of things in the internet, algorithms kinds of things. So he wrote what ultimately became a prize-winning master's thesis.
One day we were all with our families at Cheers. It was the Bull and Finch pub. It was a Saturday afternoon, I believe, and Donnie, in typical, in his, you know, understated style, he said, you know, by the way, I just won the best master's thesis at MIT. And I remember saying, listen, first of all, it's not just by the way. You know, that's huge, so you're going to pay for lunch, but, you know, what does it do? And he said, you know, it optimizes the number of hops in an algorithm. And, you know, at that time, we used to spend all our time on the internet. And so I just asked him, I said, you know, so does it have any applicability to the internet? And it was almost like a light bulb went out in his head. And the next thing I knew is that we had left the families and we were going to MIT to talk to Tom Leighton.
People didn't really understand Danny's work in the early days. You know, in fact, I remember some of our first papers on the subject were rejected at the leading conferences. You know, so when these are academic conferences, they just didn't get it. In fact, I remember we had one referee report on the consistent hashing paper that said, well, this is not going to be useful in practice, you know, so we don't want to accept it at this conference, which is sort of ironic since, you know, it was a key part of Akamai's early technology, and it's technology we still use today and many other people now use.
MIT has this thing called which is now the $100,000 competition. It was the $50,000 competition at the time. It's an entrepreneurship competition, and the first prize was $30,000, right? And so I always used to bug Donnie. I was like, I'm in business school, you're in engineering school, you're this whiz kid, you need to have an idea that, and we can do it, and if we win, we get $15,000 each, which at that time was all the money in the world and more, right? And so I used to keep bugging him about it, and he used to always say, yeah, we need to do something.
There was a pre-round before the 50K called the 1K, and there were 10 categories there. We won the software category, and that got us $100. We spent that on some beer, where Pritish Nijewan, who was our partner, was Danny, me, and Pritish in the 1K, and Pritish was in the Sloan School. And he was saying, hey guys, this is a big deal. You know, we won the software category. You know, real companies come out of the 50K. And sort of Danny and I are saying, yeah, you know. But, you know, Pritish had infectious, you know, enthusiasm and, you know, encouraged us to enter the full competition. Danny got going, you know, and when Danny gets going, he wants to win. The 50K team got to the final six of the 50K contest. They only announced first, second, and third. We were not announced. And when we saw the quality of the other presentations, we realized that they were all very good, and we had a lot to learn about business.
Like any good person who loses, I questioned the judges, and you know, I thought they had made a big mistake. And, you know, I was convinced, sitting in the Laboratory of Computer Science with these guys, we were on to something.
We started out actually getting books out of the library called How to Write a Business Plan.
I remember the first time he and Tom came in, they showed me the presentation on these plastic velographs. You know, they weren't even using PowerPoint. They were so green at the time.
You know, there was no obstacle Danny couldn't conquer. You know, the fact that he had no experience in business didn't matter. He went out and learned. We got help with the business plan from a variety of folks, the, you know, Battery Ventures, and Todd Dagris was very helpful for us.
I, of course, suspected that these guys knew what they were doing. They were incredibly smart. They surrounded themselves with some very, you know, smart and energetic people. I remember walking into the Akamai office and there were empty Jell-O containers everywhere and people were feverishly, you know, banging on their keyboards and they barely noticed that anything else was going on. And you kind of got the sense that something was happening. There was a buzz there. I used to call it the hive.
They wanted more than one venture capitalist to support them. And so they came to Polaris and we got very excited about their idea and we ended up funding it.
The team grew during the year. Jonathan Selig came on board, who ultimately, you know, went forward with the company and did some very helpful things for us.
It took us a while to understand that really the thing that was going to let the technology have the most broad applicability and to really make the technology do everything that it was designed to do and able to do, we probably wanted to own and operate the infrastructure that it was running on.
Audacious idea because their idea provided a synoptic view of the internet. It was really a better internet.
And I remember the day in the fall of 1998, we were walking from that building to our new offices for Akamai over in One Kendall Square, which is the building down there, just a short walk away from campus. And on this particular occasion, Danny was telling me why Akamai was going to be successful, you know, and he said, it's not because we've got great technology per se. And he said, you know, great technology makes a big difference. Obviously, you need to have great technology, and we did have great technology. And he said, it's not because we got really smart people at the company. That's obviously important. And we did have really smart people, you know, the best and the brightest from MIT, you know, were signing up to work at the company. And he goes, it's not because we've got a good business plan, finally. It took us a while to figure out the business plan. He said, you know, that's important. You got to have a good plan, but that's not it. You know, he said, the reason Akamai is going to be successful is because we're tenacious as hell. You know, we will never accept defeat. We will never give up. We will do whatever it takes and work as hard as we can to make sure Akamai is successful. And, you know, he was right. And that conversation, which took place walking along this path that we're walking now, sticks in my mind to this day. I can hear Danny saying the words.
It's the key to us keeping the wheels on here is product management. In order to actually make sure that you guys know what can be sold, how it can be sold, how we can support it, and how we can actually charge for it, and what, you know, make sure we build the right things, we need product management that is as accountable for this as you guys are for revenue. And we are doing that. Okay, so that was the first pillar. I hope you guys get a sense there that this is pretty huge. The goal there really is to dominate the world. Okay, second is...
Danny had his own special vocabulary. His favorite words. Obstreperous. That's obstreperous. Whenever something was annoying, he would use that word. Kerfuffle. When there was a calamity, he would use the word kerfuffle. Titan. If he had to compliment someone, the ultimate compliment you could get from Danny was to be called a titan. Non-trivial. It was a kind of cool way of saying, This is you got to pay attention to this. This is something to watch. After his meetings with George, if he was frustrated, he'd come out and he would literally bang his forehead on the wall. So I got this thing. It was perfect. I put it up on the wall and I put above it Danny Lewin anger management device. and he would come out and he would bang his head on it. And I still have it on the wall, and it's got a dent in the foam.
We got a lot of attention very quickly, and many would argue, and I would be one of them, that the persona of Danny just created a market perception rapidly that these people are intensely smart and what they're doing is highly relevant. I don't know what it is, but we need it.
Actually, we had two big breaks, and by total coincidence, they happened the same day.
The first day of March Madness, InfoSeek called us up. And they said, would you mind if we send you 2,000 deliveries per second? Now, at this very moment, we're delivering one object every few minutes for Disney, and that's us, you know, clicking on it. But we said, sure, you know, we can scale that and do that. And lo and behold, in 15 minutes, we're delivering 3,000 objects per second. Now, we very quickly learned that, in fact, InfoSeek had crashed. They were hosting ESPN's March Madness site. They'd crashed from the load. And InfoSeek noticed that not only were they back online, they were now five times as fast as they were before March Madness started. They go, how did you guys do this? You know, how is this possible?
And there's Danny with this unbridled enthusiasm and a can-do attitude that you knew that when there would be challenges, as there are with any startup, that he would overcome those obstacles by sheer intellect, sheer energy, and enthusiasm.
The other big event, by coincidence, was that night. This was the release of the Star Wars trailer.
Now, sure enough, the trailer gets released at 9 o'clock. We get it, and we distribute it. And we start looking at news stories saying that Apple's down, other sites that had bootleg copies are down, and the only site that's up is Entertainment Tonight. So a guy at CNN, Sam Gassel, noticed, investigated, and he wrote a story about this Akamai thing that somehow was the only one to be able to distribute the Star Wars trailer. Everybody else is down within seconds. And so in the same day, we had a bunch of coverage on both of those events, and it spread like mad. Before you knew it, we had lots of high-profile customers.
There was a lot of work, and Danny was always available to go, and that was one of the things that was tremendous about him, because he knew how important it was to sell this technology for the success of the company. And so he made himself available more than just about any founder you could imagine would make himself available to the selling engine to be out in the field with the customers, traveling in unpleasant time frames, environments, circumstances. He was always on.
Of course, sometimes he was bluffing, but you had to watch him a lot of times to know when he was bluffing. And usually partners or prospects didn't get enough times to recognize that pattern. But Danny wasn't above being enthusiastic and knowing we'll figure some of that out later. Usually it involved waving his hands this way and saying, that's obvious, which was his way of trying to make the other person think, oh, I'm not that smart, so it's obvious, I better back down, which of course was his way of saying, I'll get back to that.
Crazy in 99, the bubble's out there, we go public.
Big companies that invested in us, their primary asset was our stock, which is just nuts. You know, they have a $35 billion valuation, losing money, and I think, you know, tiny amounts of revenue.
After the IPO, we raised a lot of money, and we used that to grow the company. We added hundreds of employees in a short period of time, and that meant we needed more space. So we moved out of 201 Broadway, where we had a whole floor, and we took over this entire building in Technology Square. And that was sort of cool because this is the sister building to the Lab for Computer Science building that we started Akamai in at MIT. And it was really an accomplishment for us that now Akamai was big enough to have the entire building. We had that many employees at the time. This was a time of great growth and expansion for the company. It was also a time that ultimately
was a very difficult time for the company because the crash came, the bubble burst.
We had to lay off 2/3 of the company. Our customers were going broke left and right. We were at high risk of going broke at Akamai. This was a very, you know, tough time. You know, Danny was a very tough guy. He did not give up. You know, he was relentless, and he would not let anybody around him give up.
But Danny was pretty realistic, and Danny understood we needed to make changes for the business to survive. So Danny was not in his own bubble of, well, everything's fine. No, Danny recognized that things were changing and outside of our control and not positively.
He told me this once, that he was sort of in this guided missile mode, that he felt he was in this guided missile mode for most of his life. And then sort of the last year of his life, he started to calm down a little. And he started to have a better work-life balance and spend more time with the family, more time with the kids. And I noticed something about him, that he became a little calmer. He was always happy with the things he did, but it was a different kind of happiness. It was a happiness that comes from calming down a little, from settling down a little.
He was a loving, caring, doting father who was extremely affectionate and yet, you know, didn't blur the lines that he was the dad and they were the kids. Being dad was a very important part of his identity.
He was fun, silly, goofy. He was always on the go, so when he had time, either we were in the playground or we were in the car going to Newport or Rockport, to a park, to the zoo, to, you know, he was very, and the boys were smitten by him.
I used to get a little bit of a complex because he used to take Ethan to the science museum so often that when you went with the little, you know, 3-year-old boy, he knew every exhibit and what it did and how it worked. And I just thought that was amazing. So Donnie, you know, every available opportunity he had, he would be with the boys. I think my son still claims, and I think it's erroneous, that Donnie uncle taught him how to ride a bike. I think I did. I was there. But he claims that Donnie did. So, you know, it was all in the playground along with his son. So, you know, he was... every available opportunity that he had between school and other stuff, he would be with his boys. And I remember that extremely clearly. I mean, he was a very devoted father.
September 10th, we were up most of the night designing the last RIF, the reduction in force. And so we were trying to figure out which 500 employees we were going to fire the next week. It just was a horrible, horrible night. And then, well, of course, you know, Danny got 1 hour sleep, and then he was off to go to Los Angeles to do a speaking event and to meet with customers. And he was on American Flight 11.
And we knew the flight, and we knew that Danny was on it. One, because he was booked on it, but also in those days, you know, we would often miss flights, change flights. But Danny had the habit of talking on his cell phone till the stewardess took it out of his hand, kind of, and he was talking to one of our staff attorneys at the time, so we knew he was on the plane.
We contacted air traffic control. They are going to handle it for the confirmed hijacking.
The story that we heard, that the family heard, and I was with the family during the Shiva, is that he was sitting more or less in between the terrorists. I think somewhere next to him and somewhere behind him, somewhere in front of him or something around that, because they were all sitting in business class. And that when the terrorists made a move, he tried to block them from entering the cockpit, and during that time he was stabbed and killed. So he was killed long before the airplane crashed into the buildings.
I'm sure at some point it became clear to him what was going on, and I'm sure he acted. And I'm sure that somebody on that plane, maybe more than one, paid, but he couldn't get them all.
I know Danny fought back. And when I was asked to speak at his memorial at MIT, I got up and said the fact that, you know, our friend was the first victim of the first war of the 21st century is just mind-boggling.
I got in the car and drove to work, And, you know, it's your kind of thing where you sort of have this nightmare feeling, but just can't be real. So I walked into the building, and I saw Ahn in tears. That I do. September 11th was a day that proved everything that Danny had been saying, that this can be done, this solution will work. It will work in exactly this kind of environment, that, you know, there's important websites to the country that are brought down by bad guys during a national crisis, and Akamai brought those sites back online, defended them against the attacks, got the important information out to the American people and to the world. So, you know, he was proved right on that day.
Even though we had a good idea and proved it, our customers were dying so fast, people weren't sure we'd have anybody to send bills to at the end. But I think the team stayed because of Danny, because he was so compelling, his vision was so compelling, he was so right, proven on 9/11 because of how central the internet became to how people understood what was going on, that I think we stayed because of Danny and for Danny.
He was already known as a phenomenal visionary, and he was 31, right? So who knows what time would have had in store for him, but you know, people like that are once in a generation kind of minds. And when you combine that with his ability to work so hard and continually think about new things, I can only imagine what he would have done.
We only saw one great, you know, sort of obvious invention in Akamai, and I have no doubt that he would have come up with many more in the decades that should have followed. And that's one of the great losses for all of us, is we didn't get to see everything else he was going to figure out through his genius. 10 years after all those events, we're where Danny thought, maybe beyond. Back then, we were trying to figure out how to survive.
We weren't really talking about being a $1 billion revenue business, or being a member of the S&P 500, or you know, delivering 15 to 25% of the web every day. Back then, we weren't in commerce or enterprise applications or the things that we do today. So in some ways, we lived up to that bombastic idea Danny had of changing the way the internet works, but in all sorts of ways, even he probably hadn't envisioned at the time.
He thought we'd be a successful, important company, and I'd like to think that's what the team achieved in ways that exceeded any of our dreams.
Danny always had a lot of expressions that caught on. You know, we talked about Titan, you know, which is just a, you know, sort of a superhuman individual. Another one was he would go to people and tell them, "You're behind," and then he'd go kick them in the butt and try to help them, you know, do better. You know, so if I was to talk to Danny today, I'd say, "We're behind, but we did okay."
I think we would tell him that we miss him. I think we would tell him that he achieved so much in so little time. So he should be really proud of that.
I think one thing that Danny would want is more people knowing about his legacy and what he did during his brief time here. He'd want a story out there. Danny's character and loyalty as a friend, husband, father, son. Danny is the most remarkable person that I've ever met or will meet.